Once again, I'm Mary Hanley. I'm with the Voting Village pod here at the Sandbox. And I'm delighted to introduce our next talk, What's in the Box? Software Bill of Materials for IoT. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Allan Friedman.
So much. Hi. Thank you all so much for coming out today. We're going to talk about something that's always good to know, which is what's in the box. Now, I love a surprise as much as anyone else. So here's what's in this box. Congratulations. But if we're trying to think about this more logically, we're used to understanding that most of the time when we buy, say, something we're going to put in our bodies, comes with a list of ingredients, right? This isn't revolutionary. We're used to this by now. Maybe you go out and you buy a Twinkie. Twinkies are delicious. Maybe you don't care what's in the list of ingredients, and that's okay. But if you have a food sensitivity or a dietary restriction, then it's pretty important that that data is available in an accessible format. This is our vision here in trying to think about transparency, is it's a natural way of thinking about markets. Markets thrive on transparency. That's how we make the right decisions. Not all of our data is going to be there in a way that we need it, but when we want to use it, we should have access to it. So I'm going to talk a little bit about transparency in the IoT space or in the connected device space. Because again, it's devices, but it's also medical devices. It's also critical infrastructure. All of these things are software. I'm going to talk a little bit about what an SBOM is and why it's a great idea. And I'm also going to make the case that this is coming. Software supply chain transparency is going to be with us so we can get prepared now to make some progress. So first, why IoT? It's a device, but of course, it's also software. And the challenge is it's not always obvious what software I'm dealing with. There's a NTT researcher, Asuka-san, who has done this great work to say, hey, you go online and you want to buy a digital camera. It may say it's made by company X or company Y, but it turns out these are all made by the same company, Hikvision. They all have the same firmware. And oh, by the way, that firmware is vulnerable in one of the key devices in everyone's favorite IoT security example, the Mirai botnet. But it's about more than just devices, of course. We're talking about large things that go boom. Or we're talking about small things that go vzzt. And if they go vzzt at the wrong time, you brick a pacemaker, you brick a person. This stuff is everywhere. So let's flip perspectives. If we're talking about organizations, because nothing that I'm going to try to convince you of today is data that my 75-year-old father, brilliant MIT grad that he is, should be handling himself. This is about organizations taking ownership for what they have. This shouldn't be a revolutionary concept. We can't defend what we don't know about, right? Now, first step in that, in the Maslow's hierarchy, is asset management, right? If you can't do asset management, please stand up right now, walk out the door, get on a plane, go back to your organization, solve that problem, and then come back and we'll talk, right? There's a reason why it's number one in the NIST framework, why it's number one in the CIS controls. We have to start there. But it's not just enough for all software to be able to say, I know what piece of software this is, right? For the really common stuff, the big enterprise vendors, yeah, once you know what piece of software it is, they'll cover it, right? Microsoft's got you covered. But more often than not, we're going to have to look under the hood. and actually say, what is the information that's there? Because there may not be an entry for this particular industrial control system in a vulnerability database. But if they're using an outdated crypto library that allows anyone to forge a certificate, that's probably in there, and you need access to that. So, this is great, Allan. I buy it. You keep using the term SBOM. What's an SBOM? That's an SBOM. It's nothing more and nothing less than a dependency graph. Acme Appliance is built on two components, Bingo Buffer and Bob's Browser. Bob's Browser, in turn, includes some functions from Carol's compression engine. It's just a dependency graph. If you're not sure how software is made, these are things that are included in the broader process. But there's one important thing that we've added to this. If you remember the famous challenge of unknown unknowns, we're trying to make the unknowns known here, which is pretty straightforward. You just have to say how good a job you've done enumerating things. So Acme Appliance, we know, has exactly two components. We also know that Carol's compression engine has no further dependencies. That's great. We can represent that. Bingo Buffer, we don't know. Could have nothing, could have a giant real-time operating system underneath it. By making it clear that we don't know its further dependencies, now you can make the appropriate risk management decision based on what you're looking for. Now, for each of those components, what do we need? We need a way to describe them in a way that you and I both know that we're talking about the same piece of software. So, what's the supplier? What's the name? What's the version? Right? I need to know if it's up to date. And by the way, give me a cryptographic hash so that you and I both know that we're talking about the same library, and I'm pretty confident that you went and got the valid one and not the backdoored cloned one from GitHub. Pretty straightforward. Nothing here is revolutionary. We're not trying to build a brand new standard. Operationally, how much data you do want? Well, I'm a former academic, so I want all the data. Give me all the data. I understand that as we start this process, we're not necessarily going to get there. So, the minimum SBOM must include all of your top-level dependencies, and you must make a good faith effort to try to get the next one down. Ideally, as this process grows, we can recurse our way to greater transparency. But more importantly, at a certain point in our pipeline, we're going to hit some open source. And that's information that it's much more easy for you to find the right information for yourself. All right. Hopefully everyone's now on board with the basics of what an SBOM is. So how do we do it? We did not set out to have a standards development process. We wanted to take advantage of existing tools. The good news is that there's at least one standard out here today that can give us most of what we need. The less good news, or the better news, depending on your perspective, is that there's more than one protocol that can do this today. So, what do we care about? Since we only care about these relatively small number of fields, our vision is to make sure that however you want to convey it, it's all compatible. You can use SPDX, Software Package Data Exchange. That came out of the Linux Foundation. It's really useful for licensing. It's powerful. More and more people are using it every day, especially in the open source world. You can also do it in SWID, Software ID Tags. They're an ISO standard. That's great. They're internationally recognized. NIST is using them. That's another great reason to use SWID tags. We know that it's unfair to expect everyone converge on one standard, which is why our emphasis is to say, let's make sure this can scale and grow. So, Allan, is this really happening? Seems like a lovely vision, but aren't you just one random guy who just won't shut up about SBOM? Well, yes to both of those questions. I am the guy who won't shut up about SBOM, but also, this is going to happen in society. So, supply chain. It's a catchy term. We want to make sure that project is happening, that things are going forward. There's a famous line from politics, which is, we must do something. Anything can be something. Therefore, we must do anything. 2019 was the year of supply chain. 2020 is the year of supply chain. 2021, Bo, are we still going to have a supply chain sandbox? Probably. We won't have solved this. But there is now much more attention into what we're building in the world today than there ever has been. Open source has been this wonderful gift, but it hasn't been free. There's a lot of tech debt that we've got to understand. Software doesn't solve all of our supply chain issues, but it gets us a lot further. And yes, the government's gotten involved, right? Again, when we're talking about risks to supply chains, this isn't just about any random organization that's concerned about vulnerabilities. This is about national security. This is about human lives and safety. So how does government usually solve problems? Well, either we give you some money so you do things better, or we beat you with a stick until you do something better. Now, the bad news is that no one gave me a budget or staff, so I can't pay anyone to do anything. The better news is that Congress, in its infinite wisdom, did not empower me to force anyone to do anything. So I can't force you to do things. So there are some folks in the wings that do have some regulatory authority. Those of you who are not familiar with what's going on in the medical device sandbox out there, the FDA has publicly said they are going to be requiring SBOM data to make sure that before your product can go to the market, you know what components you have. But there are some other benefits that we have. One of them is understanding a broader capacity in the marketplace. It's not just about the vulnerability in your product. It's about understanding the risks across the entire supply chain. So, let's take a look at these two case studies that we have. On the top, a world without SBOM. It should look pretty familiar, by the way. The world without SBOM, when we discover a vulnerability far up our supply chain, well, first we have to get the attention of that party who's maintaining that software. And once she fixes the software, then it's got to percolate down to the next actor and then the next part of the supply chain. Who has read a paper recently that says, you know what? Let's bring back waterfall development. That was the efficient way to get things done. Now, we need a more agile and resilient way to think about this. So on the bottom, we have a vision of the world with SBOM. It doesn't magically fix any vulnerability. What it does do is give everyone the same information at time T0. So while I'm waiting for a fix, I can actually make sure that perhaps, based on my risk management, I can take certain preventive actions. I can take non-software-based mitigations. I can tune my IDS. I can segment my network. There are other things I can do while I'm waiting to see if I can get a patch, if at all, by the way. Because remember, perhaps that part of my supply chain no longer exists or doesn't care about maintaining that piece of software. The vision here is about making sure that we can actually do it. So, there are still some open questions that we as a community have to figure out. One key challenge is, what's in a name? Would foo.c by any other name be quite so vulnerable? I'll give you another example. Is your project built in com.sun.java or com.oracle.java? It doesn't matter to you you're just keeping a list of all your software components. But if you're giving that data to me, then I need to know what you're talking about. We need to do this in a machine-readable fashion. And so the vision here, challenge we have to face, is figure out how we're going to have a shared vision that foo.c means the same thing to both of us. There are a couple ways we could do this. In a centralized fashion, that'd be lovely. Problem is, centralized tracking of software, like, say, CPE, doesn't scale. And in fact, my good friends at NIST have basically said, yeah, we can't keep doing this anymore. So they've queued up SWID as a replacement to CPE. But we still need to figure out how that's going to scale for the entire open source world as well. There are a couple of ways that we're trying to figure this out. The solution is probably going to look like federation with some sort of trusted set of aliases in different areas so that we can, when we understand where there's radical ambiguities, we can solve those issues. How do I communicate the SBOM data? In some cases, this is pretty straightforward. If it's open source, just have the metadata follow the open source. Standard already talked about, SPDX is doing this today. In proprietary commercial software, well, we can put the SBOM next to the binary on disk. That's great, right? It'll follow it along. If you have access to the software, you'll have access to the BOM. I acknowledge that there are going to be a few folks, especially at first, that are a little reluctant to share that data so widely. Part of our job is to help them get comfortable with that, but also to say maybe there are some other solutions we can have. Because the data won't always be able to follow the binary or follow the source. If you've got an embedded system in the ICS or OT world, or you've got a medical device network, you may not want a scanner to go looking and hunting and poking for this kind of data. One solution that we have that's emerging is MUD, Manufacturer Usage Descriptor. There's going to be a talk on that tomorrow. If it's not on your radar for IoT or OT security, it should be. This is going to be a very useful approach. We also need to understand the high assurance approach to thinking about SBOM data. A lot of what I've talked about is really keeping honest people honest is the wrong term, but it's about saying, let's assume we've got good faith people. We just need to sort of push some supply chain responsibility upstream. But suppose I'm a big deal and I've got big deal adversaries. Not only are they going to try to corrupt my software, which they're already trying to do, but if I put some information that I start to rely on, they're going to want to corrupt that information. So how can we think about making sure that we have integrity of SBOM data? For those of you who are familiar with encryption, the old line is, crypto's easy, key management is hard. That's going to be one of the challenges that we're going to face on that front. I'd also argue that once we have this data, high assurance is going to be slightly more straightforward because we now have a way of keeping all of our data together. So you as an organization can start to figure out what you need to pay attention to, right? You've got 10,000 products. You can do some fun network math and show, okay, of those 10,000 products, here's the first 1,000 open source projects that I'm the most worried about. Whatever metric you want to use, that's fine. If you don't have one, I promise you next year on the RSA shop floor, there'll be 3 companies that will give one to you. Once you know which libraries you're worried about, you can do what folks are already doing in the marketplace today, which is watch those open source projects. We can do this in close to real time, right? If there's a bunch of commitments to a new project that have a much higher entropy rate than your average commit, well, that probably means there's a decent chance that code is obfuscated. Someone is trying to backdoor it. Or maybe they're using a developer key that had never been used in that project. It had only ever been used in this random JavaScript project. It's a good sign that that was stolen. The final thing I want to talk about today that we're looking forward to moving on to is this challenge of vulnerability versus exploitability. We spend a lot of time in security talking about vulnerabilities, as well we should. But one, we know that not all vulnerabilities are equal. And two, there are many reasons that a vulnerable library would never be exploited. Everyone loves to talk about Heartbleed, so let's use that. Heartbleed is a server-side attack, which means there's nothing you can put in a client application with OpenSSL that would allow someone to read your memory through the Heartbleed vulnerability. How can we, as a community, enable people to come forward and say, yes, this is vulnerable, but it's not exploitable. If you want your software to be cheaper, or you want us to continue to maintain this open source project, let us focus on other things. That's going to be critical at making this scale, especially as more of us start to use automated tools to monitor for potentially vulnerable code. We need to make sure that we're focusing on what really matters. There's some fun legal challenges there too. I'm looking forward to finding companies that are willing to say, this product is not actually exploitable. And it's going to be a fun challenge as companies who use this software have to decide, you say it's not a big deal, do I trust you? So, what does this mean for you? First, a real question is, can you do this today? If you can't, don't feel too bad. It turns out that very few organizations in the entire world can actually track what code they use across the entire organization. This is a hard data management problem, right? We develop software in little vertical stacks. But what could you do today, and can you start asking for it today? So there's a major American bank, a portion of which is already asking for SBOM data. Now, they don't care how you give it to them. You could fax it to them. The important thing is, if you can't give it to them, that tells them a little bit about the quality of your software and your software development process. Being able to generate SBOM data is a sign of a secure development lifecycle. Not being able to is actually also a pretty good signal that you may not have the most healthy and modern and resilient pipeline to build your process. If you're on Team Blue, what could you do with this data today? How would you integrate this into your existing processes? So that's what I want you to think about. But I want you to do more than just think, right? It's fun to stroke our chins and think. But what would it take for you to actually start to do this? If you build software, why is this hard? What makes this tricky? What tooling would you need to be able to produce this data? Now, once you produce it, there are going to be further hurdles as well. In the ICS space, there are very complex regulations. There's complex support contracts, things like that. But we can start going down that direction. So can you ask for this data? One of the things that we as a community are doing is we're going to be starting to think about what draft contract language will look like so that, one, it becomes easier to ask for this, and two, people who get requests don't get 18 different requests. They only have to do it once for all their customers. The final thing I'm going to encourage you to do is to get involved in the NTIA process. So what have we done over the last year? We've brought together a huge range of people from across the software community, open source, middleware, commercial, and the customers. It's non-regulatory. It's open, anyone can participate. And that's where the change is coming from. It's not government saying, do it this way. I would argue that my part of the US government doesn't care what the solution is, so much as the fact that there needs to be a solution, and that that solution meets the needs of the folks in the security community that need this data to better defend our organizations. Process is open. We've got a few of the group leads here with us today. So after we finish with the Q&A side of things, we can come back and you can meet them over in the supply chain village. You should check out their video game, by the way. They have a great video game that shows the dynamic between attacker and defender for securing your supply chain. So I'm going to pause there because I think there's going to be some questions or at least some comments, maybe even some rants about why this is a terrible idea. And if there aren't, there are a couple other things I can tell you about what we're doing. So if you would like to ask a question or make a cormorant, there's a mic right in front. Please use the mic since this session is being recorded.
Question, have you thought about mapping the SBOM potentially, say, with the SIM object from the web such that I could see the thing manifest in an operating state and then potentially map that?
No, so that is a wonderful idea. I believe that there are a number of parts of the ecosystem where that is possible. Our vision in this approach has been, if we want this to scale for all software, then we need to define it in a very lightweight and flexible way. Once we have that data in an organization or in a build chain, then we can start to map it to other things that we care about. I'd love to chat more about sort of that architecture approach. I will tell you that other things that we're trying to track, some folks say, I want to know not just what open source project used, but who touched it, like the provenance of the data. I think that's very useful, although I think that's also stuff that's in the repo. The other area that a lot of folks are interested in thinking about is, can I map this not just to the software side, but how it was built, right? If for those of you who are familiar with Mudge and the Cyber Independent Testing Lab, he's done some great work documenting how devices are often built. The code may be good or bad, but the way the code is built is terrible. So the vast majority of commercial routers of the consumer routers on the marketplace today don't actually have memory space protection. They don't have NextCube bits. So we can start to track that data as well.
Thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions? Otherwise, I'll give you a little bit more about our process. While I'm waiting for Gene to get to the stage, what I'm going to encourage you to do is, if they put my slide back up, that's how you can get in touch with me. And from there, you can join our group. I'll give you a background, and you can get involved. Our next meeting for the whole community is going to be in Washington, D.C. on April 15th. Very appropriate to come to D.C. on April 15th and find out where your tax dollars have been going. But in the interim, we have weekly and biweekly working group calls where the work actually gets done. But we always check in as a community to make sure that what's evolving isn't just one interest group, that it actually reflects the needs of all of us. Jean.
So there is one way that in your image was government with a baseball bat, and that is, instead of beating you with a baseball bat, they beat you with lawyers. So do you see this as, is it a goal to have this as a minimal best practice or embedded, now that the FDA has it embedded in the practical requirements of HIPAA, the practical requirements of FERPA? So for example, many universities, and I'm a faculty member, requires the student athletes who are a scholarship, often vulnerable populations, to wear real-time trackers and have that, where they have no idea who can bust into them, to pick something that's happening at unnamed Midwestern university.
So I'm going to take that question as, by the way, that's terrifying. But I think the approach that we take, right, we're the Department of Commerce. We want markets to work, and we want you to all go out and make money helping other people be more secure and helping you be more secure and serving your customers better. We are inherently non-regulatory. However, we know that government's gonna government. It's what government does. So my overall vision is to make sure that whatever tools we do have, again, come out of the security community and meet the needs of the security community and are easy to adopt by the security community and are being adopted by the security community, so that by the time, say, Brussels or Tokyo or Washington gets around to saying, gosh, this sounds like a good idea, and it's not so technical, so I kind of understand it, I'm going to put it in a regulation, it's okay because it's something we're already doing, and we're doing it not because we have to, but because it makes good sense for the ecosystem. I'm going to close by tying this into the broader supply chain question, right? Supply chain security is really messy. Everything in this sandbox touches on it, whether it's a medical device or an industrial control system or a voting machine. There's no magic cure for it, but I promise you that on the software side, almost any solution we find will start with transparency. So that's where we need to go today. Thanks for your time. Happy to chat more about this over in the ICS sandbox.